literature, all the main predictions from the inflationary scenario are fully consistent with the beautiful data we now have on the cosmic microwave background anisotropies, both on the power spectrum and on the statistics. Mm-hmm. And for example, Planck has set very tight upper limits to deviation from a Gaussian distribution, which are again fully consistent with what we expected from inflation. Now, this lecture will aim at telling you what we can expect in this field about our understanding of inflation, whether it did occur or not, and what are the properties of the inflationary potential from future CMB experiments. So, this is the outline. We have, I think you are aware of the fact that thanks to primarily to the WMAP and more recently of the Planck experiment, we have now a very good view of CMB anisotropies, especially in temperature, but we have also some good information of anisotropies in polarization. And I would like to very briefly summarize for you where we stand in this field. We will see, and I think that's known to all of you, that the situation about temperature anisotropies is quite advanced, but the situation is not as good as that in polarization. And I will try to show to you that polarization will be the way to advance in the physics, in the understanding of the physics of the very early universe of the inflationary phase. So, the future of CMB research, observational research, will be on polarization, and I will summarize for you how the polarization of the CMB is produced and what are its properties. I will especially focus on one mode of CMB polarization, which are B modes, and for those of you that are not familiar with B-modes, I will give you some information. B-modes, which can be generated in different ways, but what are most interesting are B-modes from gravitational lensing produced during the inflationary epoch. And then I will illustrate projects which are currently plan or already approved and what they are expected to provide us about, in particular, to the B-mode polarization. So now, as I mentioned, as you know, we have a pretty good understanding now of the power spectrum of the CMB. Incidentally, I think you know, but just to be sure, the standard way of analyzing the distribution of the CMB anisotropies is not of talking in terms of the angular scale, that is a quantity on the real space, but to talk about a quantity which is the power spectrum, which is defined in the transform space. So on a plane, the transformation is the Fourier transformation. On a sphere, we have the Legendre transformations. So this, working in this transform space, of course, has a cost, and the cost is that it is far less intuitive, but it has a great advantage that overcompensates for this fact that the individual modes evolve independently of each other. So here we have maybe 3,000, 4,000 multiple moments that have been measured, and each multiple moment is an independent data point. So we have as many data points as the multiple the multiples that have been measured. Now, here in the blue dots are Planck data, and you see that Planck data have error bars which are smaller than the symbols, up to a multiple moment of about 1500. up to here, and then the error increase, and we'll explain to you why. At some point the information from Planck stops, but we have information on still higher multiples from ground-based experiment, in particular the Atacama Cosmology Telescope and the South Pole Telescope, which can go down here because of the higher resolution. You know that the multiple moment is inversely proportional to the angular scale. So the angular scale, maximum angular scale around 1500 to 2000 reached by Planck corresponds to angular scales of the order of 2 to 5 arcminutes, and here we go to sub-arcminute scales. And this, of course, requires adequate resolution. The key result is that the power spectrum that comprises, as I just told you, about several thousands independent data points is described by only six parameters. And the six parameter description works very well with a few what are called anomalies. That is this lack of power in this range here. There is this, however, not very statistically significant, but unexpectedly low quadrupole moment. But apart from that, the points are fitted extremely well in terms of only these six parameters, which are the baryon density times the Hubble constant square, the mass density, so baryons plus dark matter, the dark energy density, the amplitude of the primordial perturbation spectrum, the slope of the perturbation spectrum, and the optical depth to the reionization. Only these six parameters fit several thousand data points quite accurately. Now, so what are we missing? Well, what we are missing is exactly something about how we came out to this configuration of the universe, in particular how we came out to this kind of spectrum of primordial perturbations. The power spectrum primordial perturbations that fits Planck data is simply described by two parameters. There is an amplitude. Here, this is not really a parameter. This is a reference multiple, which can be taken arbitrarily. The real parameter is here in this way of discussing things is the amplitude here. And the second is the slope of the power spectrum. This is this shape is in some sense a first order approximation, which is a generic prediction of a very large number of models for the primordial inflation. So it is not determining accurately these two parameters as Planck did. It's not enough to accurately characterize the primordial inflation field, although the fact that Planck data are fitted by only these two parameters as far as the primordial spectrum is concerned rules out a wide variety of more complicated multi-field models. Now, how can we really get a more detailed information on the physics of the very early universe? Well, we need again to have something more, to have an additional information. If we focus on the properties of the physics of the very early universe, you can notice two points on which Planck has had an important impact. The first one is that the fit is produced in terms of one single mode of primordial fluctuations, that is scalar modes. We don't need any other kind of models. We need only what are called adiabatic fluctuations, while At lower level, we do expect other kind of modes. We expect some kind of tensor modes, and we may have some models which are still consistent with present data predict that there is also some fraction of isothermal fluctuation, not adiabatic ones. The other point is that Planck has shown with a very high signal to noise that the slope of the primordial perturbation spectrum is not exactly scale invariant. The reference model before Planck was a scale invariant model, so with an index equal to 2-1. Therefore, here this term goes to unity. But Planck has shown that actually NS is close to scale invariant, but not exactly scale invariant. And this is telling us about how far the homogenization of the universe due to inflation has gone, if one wishes to accept the inflationary scenario. We have seen, perhaps you don't remember, that there are pretty large error bars here, and so you may wonder whether future experiments can improve on that. But the answer is no. The reason why it is not possible to improve, even if we have experiments which have a much higher sensitivity, is on the nature of the power spectrum. The power spectrum is the second moment of the distribution of CMB fluctuations in the transformed space. The second moment, in the case of a Gaussian distribution, and you have already heard that the Planck data are telling us that if there are deviations from Gaussian distributions, they are undetectable at the present level of sensitivity. So, assuming a Gaussian distribution is a very good approximation, if you have a Gaussian distribution, then the second moment is known from statistics as a chi-square distribution. And the variance of a chi-square distribution is given by this expression here. This standard result in statistics, and has two terms. One term is related to the power spectrum itself, and one term is related to noise. So Planck was a very high sensitivity experiment, so this noise term was very small. But you see here that even if this term was zero, when L is low, that is you are on large scale, low values of the multiple, still the fractional error on the power spectrum is relatively large. If L is small, the error is not much smaller than unity, and the only way of keeping as small as possible is to act on this F sky. F sky is the fraction of sky which is covered by the experiment. So that's why, in order to explore the power spectrum of primordial fluctuations on large scales, on low L, you need go to space. Because only from space it is possible to cover in a uniform way a very large area, essentially the full sky. So in this case, F sky would be 1, and you have the minimum possible amplitude of fluctuations. But nevertheless, the errors are large, and the point why they are large is just on the nature of the power spectrum. And it's related to the fact that the only way of damping this factor is to sample the scales corresponding to a given multiple as many times as possible. This is what this term here is telling us. So you sample many, many times, you kill to low values the error, but we have just one sky. So on the larger scales, we have just one sampling. And therefore, these errors is an absolute limit. So we are, and this is a terminology that is commonly used in the literature and that we also use in the following. We call that we have reached the fundamental limit on the determination of the power spectrum when this noise term is negligible. If we go to a situation in which it's negligible, then we are at the fundamental limit. Planck has reached this fundamental limit up to a multiple number of 15 100. Now, when we go to IL, then this cosmic various terms goes down, and therefore in the end you will end up with a situation in which the noise becomes dominant. However, in the case of Planck, the situation is that the noise was so low that the only effect capable of making the results noise dominated was the effect of resolution. If you Planck as an effective size of the telescope of 1.5 meters, which means that in the relevant frequency range, the best resolution achievable was of the order of 5 arc minutes, so this goes to this limit of 1500 in L. If we try, if you know very well the response function of the instrument, then you can try to gain information also on smaller scales. But if you go to smaller scales, of course you cannot use the full power, because you are pushing the limit beyond its natural value. And the cost for doing that is to have an exponential increase of the noise as L squared times the angular scale squared. And this is what you see, for example, here, where there is the power spectrum for produced by instrument working at different frequencies. And you see that when you consider lower frequencies, where the Planck is diffraction limited, therefore the resolution is is poorer, let's say, when we go to lower frequencies, then as you go to 70 gigahertz, for example, you start to have this exponential increase of the error at a multiple of around 1000. As you move to higher frequencies, the resolution is better, and you have that you can go to 1500. You cannot go to much higher frequencies where the resolution will be even better, because you start to be dominated by foreground emission. So the errors there increase because you are not able to single out the CMB, subtracting out the foreground signals due to our own galaxy or to extragalactic emissions. So the question is then, given the situation that we have today, is there room for improvement? We have seen that on large scales there is no hope of improving. On smaller scales, there is we are not yet at fundamental limit, at the cosmic variance limit in this range, so there is room for an improvement over here. And in this range here, you cannot do much from space, because you would need a telescope which is too big to be practical. It would be too costly to have it on the sky. And also you notice here that the CMB signal goes down very rapidly. And those of you that are familiar a little bit with the physics of CMB anisotropies know that we are here in the region of the silk damping of primordial anisotropies. So we are in a region in which other effects more related to astrophysical emissions become extremely important. So here there is room for improvement, but more on the astrophysical than on the cosmological side of the problem. The situation is different for polarization. In the case of polarization, here we are talking about this E mode that I have not defined yet. I will define them shortly. So for this E mode polarization, this dashed line here represents the fundamental limit set by the cosmic variance, and the red line here shows the limit that has been achieved by Planck. So in this case, we are not at the fundamental limit. So improving the sensitivity can produce an improvement in the measurement of the E-mode polarization. Note here that you have seen, and I will show you too, also that we have pretty good determinations of the mode power spectrum. But the power spectrum, as I just said, is a statistical description. In the case of temperature anisotropies, Planck has provided the full map. So we have in each pixel we have signal to noise of about 5. So you really measure the amplitude of the fluctuation pixel by pixel. The same is not true for the mode polarization. In the mode polarization, the signal to noise is typical of the order 1 per pixel. And so, but when you combine many pixels to get the statistics, then you go to a power spectrum which is reasonably well determined. However, there is interest also in having a good map pixel by pixel. Why? Because the map pixel by pixel tells us about the statistics of the CMB anisotropies. And one, as I mentioned before, from primordial inflation, you expect that the statistics is very, very closely to be Gaussian. In fact, many models predict that there should be deviation from pure Gaussianity, but the predicted deviations are far below the limit that can be achieved so far from Planck, and therefore improving the signal to noise per pixel can go in the direction of testing this kind of models. Now, what we have today about the outcome of inflation, apart from the the problems that the horizon problems and the flatness problem and so on that has been discussed in the previous lecture, we have some predictions, expectations about the spectrum of primordial fluctuations that I said now we know only to the first order, only to the power law approximation. Now we would like to have second order information in order to be more able to discriminate about different possibilities. So just to illustrate the situation a little bit better, now what we know from Planck is are the values of these two parameters. This one have been measured with very high signal to noise, but they are the only ones that are measured. All the other parameters that describe and discriminate among different models are not measured. We have only upper limits. So we have only upper limits of the second order term that is describing the variation with scale of this spectrum. We do not have any measurement, only upper limit on tensor modes. And the fact that NS is different from 1 implies that tensor modes must be there. But we do not know at which amplitude. We have no information on the so-called tensor to scalar ratio that describes the ratio in the power in the two in scalar versus tensor perturbations. We have only an upper limit on the curvature of the universe. This has not been measured, and so on. Topological defects and so on, and we have no information on isothermal or isocurvature fluctuations. On another side of the problem, we have information we know, and you may have heard already, that the CMB experiments are also providing information on particle physics beyond what can be determined from experiments on the ground. And one particular aspect on which already Planck has provided strong constraints and further constraints, much better constraints are expected in the future, is the sum of masses of neutrinos, of the various neutrino species, and on the effective number of neutrinos. As we will see, these constraints from Planck and from future experiment require polarization data because they come from CMB lensing, and the more easily detected effect of CMB lensing is again through polarization. What do we expect? Well, at the moment, the effective number of neutrino species determined by Planck is given by this number, so it's consistent with 3. The predicted number of the standard theory is, however, 3.046. Now you may wonder how the number of neutrino species is not an integer number. And the answer is that this number here is the number that comes in when you measure the energy content of the neutrino background in the phase in which it was neutrinos were fully relativistic, so when the neutrinos were adding to the so-called radiation energy. Now, in this case, so if neutrinos were fully thermalized, then the prediction should have been 3 exactly. But neutrinos are not completely thermalized because a fraction of neutrinos are produced in the phase of electron-positron annihilation. Electron-positron annihilation occurs after there is the possibility of thermalizing neutrinos. So the neutrino spectrum, energy spectrum, is not fully thermal, but it has a non-thermal contribution, which is this little contribution over here. So this is, if the physics of the primordial universe in the up to the moment in which we have the electron-positron annihilation is the one that we know, then we should have this one. If we measure something different, then there is something we do not understand about the physics of the early universe. And of course also you know that we have a lower limit in the sum of neutrino masses which comes from solar neutrinos experiments or even from ground-based experiments, but we have only an upper limit on the sum of neutrino masses, which is here. So at the moment we have not absolute measurements of neutrino masses of the different species. So to project ourselves towards future experiments, what we would like to improve a lot compared to the present situation is on polarization anisotropies, and in particular on these B modes that I will define in a moment. But I would like also to mention, but very, very briefly, that we are about more than a quarter of a century after the measurements of the spectrum of the CMB. The latest measurements of the CMB spectrum are still the one produced by the SCOBY experiment. Now the technology can do much, much better than the COBE-FIRAS experiment that measures the CMB spectrum. And there are discussions in the literature on which I have no time to enter, but there are lectures of previous schools in which this is discussed. The current technology will allow to detect for the first time spectral distortion. So far we have only upper limits, and these spectral distortions are providing complementary information to that provided by anisotropies on phenomena that involved energy releases during the history of the universe. And of course, in doing this kind of experiments, we have a lot of additional science that will come out for free. I mean, it's just linked, comes out automatically from the measurements. So let's come to CMB polarization. Just a short reminder to you of how the CMB is polarized. Polarization is produced by Thomson scattering. You know that the Thomson scattering cross-section goes as the scalar product of the versors that describe the directions of the incident and scatterer polarization directions. So this means that the scattering saves one polarization direction, while the perpendicular one is completely dumped out. If you have an isotropic radiation field, then the perpendicular component will come out because you will have also scattering in the perpendicular direction to this one, and this will reproduce the solar component. If you have simply a dipole anisotropy means that you have a maximum and a minimum, and then perpendicular to it is you have nothing changing, then again you come out with unpolarized radiation, because in this direction in which you have the maximum and the minimum, the average will again reproduce the right polarization component. But if you have quadrupole, so you have two maxima and two minima, then you end up with a component which is much smaller than the other, which is smaller than the other one, and therefore the radiation is polarized. Probably you have seen that the polarization is described by the Stokes parameters. In the case of the CMB, we need only two Stokes parameters, because the circular polarization is not produced by Thomson scattering. So we can say that the V Stokes parameter is zero. So we have to deal only with Q and U. And Q and U have the properties summarized here. These properties are related to a particular choice of the coordinate system. So depending on what kind of coordinate system you adopt, you will find the different values of Q and U. But if we simply consider that we need to have two components, we can choose another definition of the components we want to deal with, and this is more related to the intrinsic properties of the polarization. So rather than using the Q and U, now in the CMB research it has become usual to talk about this E-mode and D-mode polarization pattern, and in this case this is done by using a reference system which is related to the polarization itself, or to be more intuitive, is related to the properties of the plane wave on which the polarization is related, to which the polarization is related. To illustrate this, consider a plane wave that propagates from the top to the bottom, right here. So you have this direction of propagation, and so you have minima, maxima, and so on. Now, if the polarization is along the direction of propagation of the wave, or is perpendicular to it, it is called E-mode polarization. If it is at 45 degrees, it's called B-mode. So there is also a sign associated to this mode. Here the solid lines are the positive mode, and the dashed lines are the negative, so it changes sign when under. And you see here that what is the property that observationally helps us a lot in distinguishing between the two modes. Under reflection, so under a parity flip, we have that E-modes transforms into themselves. So if you have a reflection, this remains like it is, this remains like it is, but the B-mode under reflection will change sign. So this positive, it becomes negative. So this means that this behaves not as a scalar, but behaves as a pseudo-scalar. Or in other words, the two quantities are orthogonal to each other. The cross correlation between E and B is zero. And this tells us that we are describing the system with two independent components. Now, most of this talk will be, or this presentation, will be on B modes, because they are what are the focus of the current interest. But E-modes are also important, and the study of E-modes has already provided important results that you may be aware of. So I will remind you in particular of the information that has been provided on the reionization epoch. Why is this produced? Well, you know that if you are in an epoch in which the universe is optically thick to Thomson scattering, then any anisotropy is dumped out. So the if we are well before the recombination, then the anisotropies of the CMB are continually destroyed and recreated by the interaction with the propagation of density perturbations. When the universe becomes optically thin to Thomson scattering, then we are at the recombination, and then the photons comes to us, preserving the level of anisotropy they had at the moment in which the universe became transparent. Now, when you have the reionization, you have a new coupling between electrons and the photons, and the anisotropy, the quadruple anisotropy that was present at reionization is still present because of it is carried by the matter. And then this means that again you produce new polarization in the CMB, but you produced it on a scale which is very different from the scales that are produced at recombination, just because the horizon of the universe has increased quite a lot. And the detailed calculations are showing that this additional anisotropy in the polarization depends on two quantities, essentially. It depends on the epoch in which this reionization occurs, because this epoch defines the size of the horizon, and depends on the optical depth. And the optical depth defines the amplitude of this signal. And there are detailed calculations are producing this kind of approximation on the multiple number at which we have the peak of this additional anisotropy. This peak goes almost linearly with the reionization epoch and depends on the matter density, which is pretty well determined from the anisotropies measured at the recombination. So the position of the peak is telling us what is the effective redshift of the reionization. The amplitude of the signal is telling us about the optical depth. This is illustrated in this figure, where the solid line here is the power spectrum of E-mode polarization of the CMB produced at recombination. And this should go down on low multiples, on large angular scales. This is the bump produced as at reionization for three values of the optical depth, the reionization optical depth, between 0.014 to 0.034. So you see clearly the effect that higher optical depths mean higher ionization redshift, and so the peaks moves in this direction, and the amplitude is directly a measure of the optical depth. So this is, of course, complementary. We have other information on the reionization that comes from the Gahn-Peterson effect, optical UV data, and so on. But these data are telling us more about when the reionization process has ended. This is telling us about the full process, the full optical depth across the full period at which the universe was reionized. So this reionization peak shows up in all power spectra related to polarization. So EE mode, that the autocorrelation spectrum of the EE mode that we have seen before, also in the case of the BB, the B mode, and also in the case of the cross correlation between temperature and E mode. There is no cross-correlation between temperature and B-mode for a reason that I told you before, that you probably don't remember, because B-modes are pseudo-scalars, have an odd parity, while T is a scalar, has an even parity, so the cross-correlation between even and odd parity goes to zero. There is no cross-correlation. So the strongest signal here is the TE cross correlation, but, and again, this is something that has been discussed in the last year's lectures, this is not the most efficient way of measuring the reionization. and this led to a first estimate by WMAP that was wrong by almost a factor of three. Why the TE mold is not good for measuring the reionization optical depth? Well, the reason is illustrated in this figure. The TE, we are dealing here with low multiples, so large scales, and low multiples, you know, we are strongly limited by the cosmic variance, you remember? And in the TE, you have the error is dominated by the cosmic variance due to T and to the cosmic variance due to E, but since T is much stronger than E, then what dominates is the cosmic variance on T. And this produces an irreducible uncertainty that large. This is mostly cosmic variance due to T. There is another reason why this is not particularly efficient, and that the dependence on the optical depth is linear because it's carried only on by E. While if you consider EE, the cross-correlation, the autocorrelation, then the dependence on the optical depth goes to S tau square because each E carries a dependence on the optical depth. So this is the way of determining the best constraints on the optical depth to reionization, and this is the kind of information on which the results recently published by the Planck group in this reference here is based. So you may remember the very original, the very first determination of tau by WMAP was 0.17, which was in a striking disagreement with the estimates that came from the Gunn-Peterson effect, which were between 0.4 and 0.04 and 0.05 down here, roughly. But this was based on TE. And in fact, if you read the WMAP paper, they put a warning in the text, but then they quote this error, so apparently this is a 4 sigma detection. So everybody takes this number, don't read the caveat in which they were saying, be careful because the error is actually much larger than that. Next, in the subsequent determination, WMAP added also EE, so the estimate of tau went progressively down until the last estimate is this one, 0.055, which is within one sigma of the expected value from the Gunn-Peterson effect. So this has been taking out the motivation for having a two-step or more-step reionization in order to account for this value. Models had to say that what the Gunn-Peterson effect is just the last reionization episodes, but before that we have other episodes that you cannot see in the optical UV, but you see in the CMB. There is no more need of that. So about the modes, the dominant perturbations that we have are the scalar perturbations, as I said many times. The scalar perturbations produced quadruple anisotropies in two ways. One way is when the perturbation is collapsing, and one is when it is expanding. We are and in both cases, you have E-mode. So you have something which has an even parity. If you reflect this, you reproduce the same configuration. so only e-modes. Tensor perturbations are stretching of the space-time, and therefore the stretching of space-time can be decomposed into something that is again related to acceleration or deceleration, but also of some deformations. And while this part here produces again e-modes, this components here produced b-modes, like that, in which the parity is odd. How this happens? Well, you have here a gravitational wave coming towards you. The stretching of the space-time produces configurations distorted. If you have electrons inside this region to which the gravitational wave is propagating, this region sees radiation, which is when you have compression, and it is cooler in the perpendicular direction where you have expansions. This is a quadrupole clearly, two maxima and two minima. This quadrupole produces polarization, and the polarization is in this direction. I must go quickly through that. So you have, in this configuration, you have situations in which you are